led a very interesting life, and I hope he's going to tell us something about it. Allan, where were you born?
Kennebago Station. September 7th, 1918.
And you stayed there how long?
Until November. Because my mother passed away in the flu epidemic. My father brought us children out to Grammy's in Upton, and we stayed there for I'm not sure how long, and then we moved down here to Bethel with my grandmother, and then after she passed away, I went to Norway to live with my aunt down there for probably 6 years, and I came to Andover to live with my aunt in Andover.
How many were in your family?
Three, two boys and a girl. Yeah.
Then you went to school in Andover?
Yeah, graduated in Andover.
What year was that?
36.
36. Yeah. Okay, so what do you remember about school in Andover?
Well, let's see, I went to school up to number 4, the old one-room schoolhouse up there for, what, 1 year, I guess. Well, 2 years up there, I think. And I had the 8th grade at the Elm Street School and then high school. Had very good teachers. And we all had a good time. We had to make our own thing. We didn't, nobody, there was nothing going on. You had to make your own entertainment.
You go to a lot of the dances and plays and?
Well, some. Movies from Saturday night, which you could scrape up 15 cents.
How'd you get downtown? Walk?
Well, it was walked. Walked many, 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 many miles. A mile and a half to go to school every day.
So what'd you do after you graduated, Allan?
Went to the woods.
Okay, now what do you mean by the woods?
Well, I went in working in the woods doing, well, I cut some and then I went to driving team.
Who were you working for?
Thurston Brothers. And when I was, I think the summer I was 18, Ray sent me up to Campbell Brook with 16 horses to go up there do the feeding and the toting. That was, I was there, well, way into February, I guess, when we got done on that job, and then I went over to South Arm. Up there.
How often would you come out?
Once every 3-4 months. Oh, I see, I went in August. I came out one day for Christmas, went back, never come home till April. Oh, yeah.
What were your duties?
Well, when I was feeding, I had to feed, get up in the morning and feed the horses, get the teamsters up so they could get the horses ready to go to work. And then after I got my chores done around the barn, I hooked up my tote team and had to go out to the road to get a load of hay or the groceries.
Now, how many horses were there?
16. And then after, oh, I don't know, probably in October or November, the blacksmith quit and went out, and if a horse needed a shoe, I had to nail it on. So I'd done some of the blacksmithing, along with everything else.
Did you all live in one camp?
Yes, we did up there. We had one big camp. And well, when we went in, there was a group of us from Andover that had a big tent. We lived in that until it got too cold.
Now, who was in the group?
Let's see, Basil and Elvin Morton, Basil Hutchins, Elvin Morton, Dave Carter. Oh, well, I did a couple more, but I can't remember now who. No, it was a small crew. And after we started hauling, I went to where you could drive in with the truck, because they were trucking the wood out, so we didn't have to have any tote teams. I went to hauling wood out of the swamp to go up onto the truck roads. And back in those days, Basil was my striker, and we made pretty good money.
What was a striker?
Well, he helped load the oil, helped load and unload the pulp. So, I think, what was it we got? I think we got 55 cents a card to put it to haul it onto the road. I guess it was 30, we divided it up somewhere, I don't remember how. But anyway, I don't know how much it was, but I know there were days there that we would haul all probably 20 to 26, 28 cards of wood out of from the stump to the truck road.
Now, you always had a cook.
Oh, yeah, cookie, clerk in the office, woods boss. No.
How many winters did you do that?
Oh, I was there for Thurston Brothers, probably 3 winters.
Now, would you stay in the same location?
Oh, no.
All the time?
No. He was up to Campbell Brook, that's halfway in from Eastby Hill Road to the Sluice Dam, and then I went to South Arm. 2 winters I was up in South Arm, 2 winters to 2 different camps up to on the back side of the arm. And then I went back to the Sluice Dam on the Cambridge. That was the last winter I worked. then I went south to southern New Hampshire to cut hurricane timber.
Now you told me once about bringing a lot of horses out in the spring.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Where were you when you came out with them?
I was up to South Arm, over across.
Now, what time of year was this?
Oh, that was in April. You know, I didn't have room down at the town for the horses, so I stayed up there. I had 40 horses up there to take care of. And
were you by yourself?
Yeah. And I just turn them loose every day and let them run a couple of 3 hours, and they'd come back and I'd put them in. And one night there was one of them didn't come, and I didn't know how it was. And I said, it'll show up sometime. And next day I looked up across the pocket, across towards the lake, and there it come down the lake where it had been. I have no idea. And then when they called up, told me it was time to bring the horses out, there was about a foot of water on the ice. The ice was honeycombed, so it was, a horse would sink in about 6 inches into that honeycombed ice. And I had to hook up the 40 of them head to tail and take them across the lake to get them onto South Arm.
That must have taken quite a few ropes to hitch them.
Well, they all had halter ropes.
Yeah.
You used the halter ropes, so it could take 2 half hitches around the other one's tail. And when I got out to the main road, out to the road, I unhitched them all, and there was one old black horse there. They knew where he was going, and he headed down the road, and you didn't have to worry. He was headed for home.
Now, weren't you a little bit apprehensive, wondering if you were going to hit a place in the ice that...
Well, yes, I was. you sweat a little bit. Well, that was honeycombed that way. But, of course, it was... Oh, probably 18 inches of ice, so really there was, I don't think there's, unless it'd been an air pocket, I don't think there'd been any danger, but there was a danger.
Now, did they very often lose horses?
Oh, no, you didn't. Very, very, very seldom. I don't know, Thurston's, up there was the 2 years we were on the lake, we didn't lose any, but other job was that Mike Marshall lost a team over on the Embegog that one winter, and other places they lost them at different times. But no, there was the ice was up there the second winter. They rolled the snow roller and they packed it down so the ice there was frozen in good shape and it would hold a lot of extra ice more than common probably.
Now, how long did it take you to walk them down to Andover?
Well, I don't know. I got up probably at 4 o'clock and fed them. And then I got my breakfast. Then I went out and started hitching them up. Probably I probably left around 9. And I would say for a guess, it was probably 4:30, 5 o'clock when I got to Andover. Long, long 11 miles.
So who do you think was tired, are you or the horses?
Me. Well, I had my knapsack on my back, all my clothes and everything. I had to lug that. Say, but the horses never bothered. Well, I say they never bothered. They never bothered until they got to the village. And when we got to Merrill Bridge, some of the teams that had come out before us cut across from Merrill Bridge across the field and up through to Thurston's Barn. Well, that old black horse, see where them other teams went, and that's where he went. And the rest of them all followed him. But after we got up there in the barn, of course, a lot of the horses had never been there. And we had a little bit of a time rounding them up. We had to chase a few around town.
What, did he leave them all right there at the barn?
Well, for a while, well, a lot of them was sold and he shipped them out right after I brought them out. Back in those days, men would come down, potato farmers from Aroostook County would come down and buy their horses right in the woods while they was working and then pick them up when he was done with them. So that's what, well, a lot of the horses went, except the ones he wanted to keep for another year. And so it was an experience. It was, well, enough. But, no, and when you work in the woods, you go through a lot of those kind of experiences. You never know from one day to the next what's going to happen.
Were there any moose in the woods back then?
Very few. When I was at Capitol Brook, that's when I saw my first moose. When I was at the hay shed, from where I came out to the main road, the hay shed was down about a mile towards Andover. And one day I was driving down, and, well, wasn't paying too much attention, I guess. And a moose stepped into the road in front of my team. They was young, and they did it foolish, and they took off. We had a little circus before I stopped them, and then them turned around and come back. They was going places. And that's the only moose I saw for probably, oh, 3 or 4 years. Just why he was there, I don't know. But it was just one of them. Well, it's the only one I've ever saw there for so quite a long time. Of course, now they're plentiful.
Yeah, they are. So what did you do after you worked in the woods, Allan?
Well, I went to New Hampshire to cut hurricane pine.
What do you mean by hurricane pine?
1938, when the whole country blowed down around there. Acres and acres, hundreds and thousands of acres of wood was flat. Down there, the first job I was on in New Hampshire, there was probably 350 acres, what we call, well, hard pine or Norway pine, and they make telephone poles out of. And when it was standing, about 2 weeks before the hurricane, the company tried to buy that stumpage. It got wind and thin it out, and the guy said, "No, I don't want to cut any of it." He was a millionaire, he didn't care. And after the hurricane, he sold it to him real cheap, get rid of it. And we was there almost a year cleaning it up. And that was one awful snarl when they was crisscrossed up 5, 6, and 7 deep. What a job done snarl. I mean, boy, the company didn't want you to break one of those poles. They was worth big money. When they hauled them down to Nashway, New Hampshire, to the treatment plant, And peeled them and then creosoted them down there for light poles, telephone poles or whatever. They was worth, they were just like gold. It was quite a long drag that year, getting them out of the woods. Yeah, on that job, I done everything. I drove team, I drove tractor, drove truck. Whatever had to be done, I was doing it.
Did you enjoy driving horses?
Oh, yeah. Loved it.
You must have had some good favorites.
Yeah, I had, well, my team that I had at Camp Brook, I was towed in with, I think was the team I liked the best. It was a young team, a beautiful pair of dapple grays. Nice team, except for one thing. There was one of them, when you turned it out of the hobble or barn to go hook on his wagon, he'd go out and lay down in the mud and roll. There was no way I could. I tried and tried and tried to stop that horse from doing it. I'd have to lead him out. The only way I could. A nice team was a pleasure to drive.
How much was a nice team worth back then?
Oh, I would say probably a good team back then would average around $700. Seems though that's what the price was down to sale stable. A good team right from the west. In other words, the strangest team I ever drove was when I got down up to Campbell Brook and I went over to South Arm. Well, when am I going to take my team? And Ray said, no, there's a team waiting for you. Well, I got over there and there was a pair of odd horses and nobody wanted them. I walked in behind and there was a big chain up behind them. I said, what's the matter here? Somebody said, oh, they like to kick. Well, I learned that they did. They could do anything. They could kick, bite, strike, they'd do anything. And the first time I hooked them onto a set of sleds, I didn't get out of the campyard. So all the afternoon, spend all the afternoon with them, never get out of the campyard. But I did the next morning. We went up the mountain, and after that they'd mind. We had to have a little education, that's all. I wouldn't really say how I done it, but all the teams you drove all had their peculiar things about them. One team would do one thing, another. You never knew what was going to be when you took a new team. They were always different.
Now, did you ever work with the trains in the woods? Were they hauling logs out with the trains?
No, all horses in the woods. Until later years when we used tractors.
No. And you didn't work with any Lombards?
I didn't. My brother did over in New Hampshire, but no, I never did. It had been quite an experience, I guess, to have.
So what did you get into after the hurricane, Pine?
Well, after the hurricane, I down southern New Hampshire, and I, well, done several small odd jobs, and then I went to work for the cutlery shop in Antrim, New Hampshire, making handles for paring knives and butcher knives and things. I learned that trade. And I worked there till I went in the service. Well, that was probably a year and a half, maybe 2 years. And that was quite an experience to get down and know how to do that. And after that, I was in the service for 4 years, three of them overseas in England. And when I came home, I went back to the woods again. Well, back to the woods in the sawmill, worked in both. This guy in southern New Hampshire. And then after, I don't know what, 47, 48, I moved back to Andover. I worked at various jobs around there. So, worked in the woods some, worked in one of the mills, one or two of the, well, both Swain's Mill and the mill up above Andover. And so, the woods was what I liked the most, and then I had the chance to go for the Brown Company scaling. I went for them for 15 years, till I retired.
And you must have been traveling around with that all the time, weren't you?
Miles, a lot of weeks, you put in 1,000 miles a week. No, when I was staying at home and driving back and forth, it just averaged close to 1,000 miles a week, because I was working way up country. Well, back up again, up above Kennebago, and it was a long drive every day. Well, I stayed in the camp some of the time, and then I spent 1 year over in Island Pond, Vermont, looking after jobbers for them. Of course, I stayed right over there. They paid my board and room at the hotel, so that wasn't too bad. Over there we filed, what was it, around somewhere in the neighborhood of 10,000 cards of hardwood pulp in the old railroad yard over there. Stockpiled it because they didn't want to haul it to Berlin. They left it there and they were ready for it. And that was a busy job looking after that.
Now, Allan, when you worked up for Thurston's camp, you must have seen those snub machines.
Oh yeah.
Work.
I've worked. I've hooked on to them.
So maybe you could explain how they worked a little bit to us.
The cable has to be wound around the drum just so to have it come out right. And then underneath, there's a big caster, well, casting, I suppose you'd call it, that everything sets on. And then underneath I guess you call them pulleys maybe, there was rock maple blocks, and those was your braking system. The more pressure you put on pulleys, down onto the rock maple blocks, that is what held them. You had two handles. You could use two or four, whatever you needed for pressure to slow the sleds down. And it took a pretty good man to keep you going smooth down the mountain. He knew a man after a little while, he could watch them and he knew just how fast you was going. And then he had the snub machine man had to watch what we call the toggles. Here there's what they call a toggle on each end of the cable that hooks onto the sled. When he saw the toggle coming up the hill, he had to watch, and he knew that you was about done, and he had to snub you down and slow you. If he pulled back too hard on the levers and snubbed you too fast, he'd stop you dead, and you'd come back up the hill when the stretch of the cable would bring you back up the hill. So you had to be very careful. And another thing they had to be very careful about, especially in the morning, was taking the frost out of the toggles. First thing the man done on the snub machine was build a fire and get the toggle hung over the fire to take the frost out of it so it wouldn't break. And then, it's quite an experience the first time to hook onto a snub machine and go down over, because once probably you go twice the length of your sled and you're gone. That's the only thing that's saving you, is that cable and the man on the machine.
Did they always work?
Oh yeah. Yeah, very, very faithful machines. And I believe, I don't know if it's in this article or another one I have, that they was invented, I believe, in 1914 in Wisconsin. So they was around for quite a while, and I was just reading in here that They even took some over to France in World War I. They had them over there for somewhere, whether it was logging. Of course, they had logging outfits over there from around here. There was quite a few of the men from Andover was over there. So.
Now, did other companies have them besides Thurston's?
Oh, yes, everybody. Well, anybody that was on steep ground had them. Of course, on short hills, you could use what they call the stump snub. You cut a tree off up probably 5 feet high, or one over probably 18 inches through, and you'd have a manila rope, and you'd take about two turns around that stump. And then you'd have pins, and you'd put in there, and over one of the pins or a hole, and you'd take a bar in, and one man could press down on that and hold you most anywhere. They didn't use those mostly when they was yarding on steep ground or stub twitch horses, but they did use them some on sleds on short poles if it was only 300-400 feet. But after that they went to cable. The longest cable that Thurston's had was a 30 miles. That's a long, long trail down the mountain.
I guess so.
Yeah.
And those were all left right in the woods, weren't they?
Well, yeah, they left them up there on the Cambridge, and they've just got them all out now. But you got one, there's one here in Newry and one in Berlin. Nice old machines. Saved a lot of headaches, boy. Lots of headaches. It's the only way you could really get wood off a steep ground safely. Oh, you could have a toggle break, but I never knew of one breaking, not on the job where I was, but I've heard they did, but I expect they probably did. They didn't get the frost out of them.
Allan, when did you use a chainsaw? When did chainsaws come into it?
The first chainsaws that I remember might have been probably was a few out earlier than that, right after World War II, probably in 45 and 46 they began to come out. It was very, well, according to today's chainsaws, very crude.
What kind were they?
Oh, they had weird names, I can't remember. There was a Lombard. Oh.
You've got a picture there of one, haven't you?
Yeah, this one here, we don't know what the name of it is. This is a 1918 model that somebody dreamed up, and I don't know much about it, only what the picture showed. But it must have been an awful big job to move it around through the woods when the engine was a separate piece and you had to hook it together when you got there. It was really quite a machine, but that was the start anyway. Maybe there was early ones, but I don't know of any. the early chainsaws weren't very dependable. You all had a lot of trouble with them. And the big two-man saws was awful, awful heavy to lug around. I don't know, they must have weighed 150 pounds, some of them. Or they was very, very heavy. But it was in the 50s before they really began to get a chainsaw that was comfortable to work with. The early ones, everybody tried them, but they never had much luck with them. You might take go in the woods and work 5 or 6 hours all right, and then you'd have to bring it out and have it repaired and go back again the next day, and that was what you were doing all the time, was carrying them back and forth, those early ones.
Well, you must remember snow rollers, too.
Oh, yes, I remember those since, probably I was four or five years old. I remember those because where I lived in Norway, they rolled all the roads. And it was Well, you had to be very careful when you were driving team not to run off over the edge. You'd run off over and cut into the soft snow, tip your sleigh over. But it was a wonderful place for kids to slide on the hills where they rolled them. They were just as nice and smooth as a floor, and you could really go.
Now, were those used with two horses?
Oh, and they were either four or six, depending on what the hills were. Yeah, most of the time down around there where I lived in Norway, they always had six horses on.
They couldn't have moved very fast.
Oh, no. No, but they got around. They got the snow rolled down so you could go. That's quite a difference from today. But there was, well, and then, of course, there was some show of pieces of road back where there weren't many houses. They didn't bother to roll them. Somebody on the road would hook a pair of horses onto a front sled, put a 8 or 10 foot log and chain it underneath the runners and drag that down the road to make a road. Wasn't much of a road, but anyway, it was a help.
Now, do you remember the snow rollers in Andover?
No. When I came to Andover, that was the first year they had the snow plows. Big difference. Back then, when they first came, when they first started using snow plows, I don't know about everywhere, but in Andover, they were supposed to leave 4 inches of snow on the road so people could haul the sled. They couldn't plow it down like they do today. You had to leave. And boy, the roads would get rough and icy and miserable to drive on. Boy, it was terrible.
It used to be terrible down by the airport, didn't it?
Oh, yeah, the airport is right. I saw it one time down by the airport when they were there with the big tractor plow, and I guess there must have been, I wouldn't dare say how many men shoveling, taking some off ahead of it. I think there was something like 8 or 9, 10 hours to get by the airport. Well, the snow was drifted so deep, we sat on the cross arms of the telephone poles. You didn't have to climb, you just walked up the snowbank. So we had a little bit of snow.
Just so. What year was that? Any idea?
32 and 33, I think. I'm not sure. 32 and 33 or 33 and 34, and I'm not sure. But it was we had a lot of snow and awful, awful cold weather. It went down, seems to me something like right around Christmas time or a day or two after Christmas. The thermometer dropped down to 30 below zero, and I guess it must be 10 days or 2 weeks before it ever got up to zero again. Mm. It was wicked. Trying to do anything.
Allan, how did you happen to get so interested in all this historical stuff? Was there any one thing that made you start collecting it or really start appreciating it more?
Well, no, I can't think that there was any one thing. It was just, I would go to an auction and I'd buy a box of stuff, and in it there would be one or two things that should be saved. And I'd put them away. Then I started buying postcards for the lot. And that way I collected a lot of postcards. And I just kept, whatever happened to hit my fancy for a while, and then I began to really concentrate more on Oxford County area. Oxford County, and I've got quite a collection of White Mountain stuff too. But that's what I mainly collected, tried to collect over the last number of years, was Oxford County stuff. Altogether, probably I have, 15,000, 16,000, maybe more postcards, and thousands pictures and slides of that I've copied of everything. And I got into copying for one reason. I wanted some pictures copied And you go out, go to one of these places, and the first thing they do, did, and they don't quite suppose they still do, they charged you $5 for the negative. And then they printed the picture. Well, I said, that's for the birds. So I went and bought my own camera. I wore one out and I wore my second one.
Yep, I believe it.
Yep.
So what changes do you think, since you were a little kid, are the most important, or which do you think?
Ooh. Well, I guess, well, communications have got to be a lot better. I mean, the old hand crank telephone was, well, once the most dependable thing in the world, and now a telephone and things like that are very dependable, I guess. And, of course, the things to help the women in the house, the washing machines and all those things. Back when the first washing machine I ever saw was an old square tub Maytag with a gas engine, and some days it would start, some days it wouldn't. So those kind of things, I think, are the things that have really made the country. I mean, it made everybody's work a little bit easier. And sometimes you wonder some of the things, I don't know if they were necessary, but most of those things, new stoves, new heating systems for houses, all those kinds of things made it much better today. If we didn't have them, we'd be back burning wood completely.
Now, do you think, can you name a few things that you think that the young people now are missing out on that were there before?
Missing out on.
Well, changes.
I don't know how to say this. One thing they are missing out on and don't realize what it's like, and that was to live through the Depression years. When you lived through the Depression years, you didn't have nothing, you didn't want nothing, but when you got enough money to go to the movies, you were very fortunate. And things like that. But you, well, in this area, I don't know of anybody that went hungry. I mean, they didn't have much to eat, but they didn't go hungry. Of course, other places, they were different in the cities. But up here in the country, everybody had a meal, I mean, because, well, everybody back in those years, they had a cow, they raised a pig, and they grew about everything they wanted. They were almost, you know, self-sufficient. And then even back then, if you wanted to work, you could get a job, but you didn't get much money. Back in the Depression years, if a man, head of a household was working, he might get $1 a day. Well, he got by. When I was old enough to go to work, I never wanted for a job all the years since I was old enough to work. I could always find a job somewhere to do. I didn't get big money on some of them. But now one year on spring, during the spring vacation, I went on the drive. Well, I got $1 a day in my board, but I had the job, I had the money. Otherwise, I'd been hanging around town doing nothing.
What do you mean you went on a drive?
Well, we were...
A river drive?
River drive was for Thurston. Well, one year I started... Well, that year I was just on for a week, but... we were fire. Somewhere on the Ellis, but I can't remember where. No, I guess, yes, we were up... We were bringing wood out of Dunn's Notch, I think, that year. I worked a week. And then the next year after I graduated, I worked the whole drive. We started in Dunn's Notch and went through the Sawton Gap down by Madison's Cabin.
Was the river really deep enough and wide enough to drive much wood down?
Oh, yes. Yes, we one year out of, I guess, between...
What was the sodding camp?
The sodding gap? Well, down to, somewhere, where Madison's motel is now, they had piers out there and boomed, and the wood all came down to the IP wood and the Oxford Paper Company wood all came down the Androscoggin together. And there they had a boom down the middle of the river down to Rumford, so the Oxford wood went on one side to the Oxford mill, the IP went on the other, and men stood there and picked the wood out, whoever's wood. It was all stamped with their letter on the end of it so they could tell whose wood it was. And this one wood would go here and the other wood would go there. They had to keep it each side of the center boom, whose wood it was. It was probably, in my opinion, one of the most boring jobs a man ever had. But yeah, there used to be, I guess it was one spring there, I bet there was over 50,000 cord of wood down there in the sodding gap, waiting to be sodded.
So how often did you fall in?
Oh, every day. But now, you probably heard of him. I don't know if you ever knew him, old Vean DeLong.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he was the boss on the river. And he always told us young fellas, he says, you know what you want to do the first thing in the morning is jump right in and get good and wet all over. He says, then you won't mind it the rest of the day. Well, you take it in the water there and it had a little ice froze along the shore and you go out and jump in, it ain't hot.
Now, did anyone very often drown doing that?
Very, very seldom.
I remember, a stone in the Grafton Cemetery,
yeah.
That said that it was a river driver.
No, I saw, I don't know how you would explain it. I was up for a few days up to Black Brook throwing in landings, and they just brought in a bunch of guys. One of the taxis out of Rumford brought in a bunch of guys down there to go to work. We was working there on the landing throwing wood in. All of a sudden, I don't remember, I have no idea what the nationality was, Polish or what, but he started screaming. And he run right off the landing, right out over the wood and into the river, right into Black Brook, right into that fast current, and disappeared before anybody could get near him. They never found him until the next summer, some fisherman found him. But it wasn't the drive that done it. He was just getting over the horrors, or whatever you want to call it. very seldom ever happened. I don't believe there'd be one a year around up far away.
Well, that was good.
And another job that I, after we got down on the lower end of the river, I used to be the center man on the bateau, one of the bateau crews, picking centers. We'd go along, and anything that was hung up on a rock or anything, I had to pull it off as we went by. And that was quite an experience. A bateau was one of the nicest boats that anybody ever was in. And I don't think you can tip one over. I've tried and tried and tried, but we never could. And they're a thing of the past now.
Well, you've been talking about a lot of past this morning, and I guess it's great that people like you help preserve it so long.
Well, no, I'm glad to see different places preserving these old things. Because if we don't preserve them now, they're going to be gone. Now, you see, you've got the snub machine. That goes way back in the past, and other places. Berlin, you see, they're building that new place, supposed to be a whole logging outfit up there, and then up to Patton, they've got that big logging museum. Rangeley's got a nice museum started. So, I try to help them out a little bit when I can.
You certainly have. What were the logging camps really like then? Did they really all sleep in one bed like you read sometimes? Oh, what's that?
Yeah, the first year I went in the logging camp. There was, I don't know how long the camp was, but there was one long bed, the whole length of it. No spring, just boards.
Did you each have your own blankets?
Oh, well, each yeah. two. Two.
Oh, your two blankets?
Two. Oh, yeah, double blankets, there were two. And there were boards and about 6 or 8 inches of straw. You throw the blanket on top of that and crawled onto it and you pulled another one over you. And then it wasn't too long before the state said, well, that's not good. So they went to making, well, I guess you would call it individual double bunks. It was sort of a bed spring, a double spring used. You had top and bottom, of course. And then that went on for, and let's see, you had something like 18 inches between each bunk then. Then they decided that one right. So the state made them change all over and go to single springs. So you had a double bunk, you had a bottom bunk and a top bunk with a single spring with 18 inches between.
Now, did you ever hear the word lice when you was in those camps?
Lice? Oh, I heard it. Know what they're like. The year that we was up to, first year I was up to South Arm, that was an old set of camps, been used a couple of years before, and I think all the lice had stayed there from the camp 2 years. They'd all increased to the point where you could almost throw your shirt on the floor, it would go across the floor. Oh yeah, we used to catch the big ones and put them on the, what we call the deacon seat in front of the bunk, and we try to race them.
Now, were the meals pretty good? I mean, you usually have meat?
Well,
did
there
you have
again, depending on what you're talking about, you had a good 3 meals a day. The first thing you had on the table 3 times a day was baked beans.
Oh yeah.
Never failed.
Yes.
But you'd have potato, you'd have pot roast, pork roast, you know, and it was...
Now, did you have venison?
No.
Venison? No venison?
Wasn't allowed. The state didn't allow it.
Oh.
Oh, no, you couldn't have... They catch you with that in the camp, and you would have... You paid.
Oh.
No, what you ate, how good you ate, all depended on the cook. If you had a good cook, you ate well. But after a cook was in camp for, probably 3 months or so, he would get the itch to go to town and he wouldn't cook good, and they'd send him to town for a week or two and he'd come back and go to cooking again. He was all right.
Well, so everything was homemade.
Oh, yeah, so you better believe it. Now, the first year we went up to South Arm, she had, I think it was something like 110 men there. And they had, let's see, they had the first cook, the second cook, and 4 cookees in the cookroom. Well, the first cook, all he done was bread and pastry. And I don't know, he told me there were days he stirred up 1 barrel of flour a day.
Wow.
That's 196 pounds of flour. But that went then, they didn't come with a barrel, it came with a half. It came by the bag, 98 pounds to the bag. The old days, it came with a barrel. And
now, could most of these men speak English in the camps, Allan?
A little. Some.
What nationality were most of them?
You name it.
Had a lot of Canadians.
You name it. No, we didn't. Back years ago, we didn't have too many. We had more Polish, Lithuanians, Swedes, Norwegians. I don't know. In the early days, we didn't have as many Canadians as they do now. I don't know why.
You used to get them
why.
Like from Nova Scotia and PI after a while.
Nova Scotia.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, we had a lot of Norwegians and Finns there for 2 or 3 years, several years, but I don't really know why, but they just, well, a lot of them, of course, their family is a relation of somebody had moved into the Norway West Paris area, Finns and Norwegians down there to farm, and these people come over and joined them probably, and then when the farm work was done, they came to the woods in the fall. I suppose that's where a lot of them, well, I know a lot of them lived down around there, quite a few of them. But we had Russians, we had, I don't know, I wouldn't begin to say what all the different ones were.
Now, was it usually quite harmonious, or was it?
Oh, they all got along good. Oh yeah, you had very, very seldom everything. But the only time there was any trouble was at the game when they was playing poker. Somebody once in a while get mad playing poker, but most of the time. And that was another thing that went on in the camp continuously every night from supper till lights out was a poker game. At least one, if not two. Some of them got to be pretty big stakes.
And, now, did any of those men ever come out in the spring owing money?
I think the most of them had a paycheck when they came out, maybe not too big, but no, all of them, most all of them had a pretty good paycheck because they were good workers. They worked piece work, the most of them, and they'd done all right.
Now, did they have like a company store or any place that you could?
Well, we always had a office where they sold tobacco and cigarettes, clothes, boots.
Mittens.
Right there in the camp. And that's a clerk's job. He had to sell that stuff. Along with the book, bookwork. And that was a very busy job for somebody. A job I never wanted.
What was the best job around the camp like that?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if there was any really best job. It depended on what you wanted to do. If you wanted to cut with a cord, that was the best job. If you wanted to drive team, I suppose that was your best job. I mean, it depended. Everybody had their own thing they wanted to do. As far as I was concerned, I didn't care about cutting. I liked to drive team. So, that's what I done most of the time. Except when I was, well, in the fall, getting the roads ready to haul, I was to work on what they called the road monkey crew, going up and down all the two sled roads, putting in the side skids and getting them so we could get them ready to haul on.
Now, when you come out in the spring, would you start another job immediately?
No. No, you'd usually come out in the spring and you'd wait around for the drive. Probably be, well, could be, well, 2, 3, 4 weeks maybe. So sometimes first in the time we come down to farm and work some of the time exercising horses. We had a lot of horses down there, they had to be exercised. That was quite a headache when you had to start exercising horses. You take harness four of them, put them on a dump cart and go around the 4 mile square and take them back, put them in, harness four more. But you had to keep them exercised. That was with the horses, you couldn't let them stand. You'd have sick ones if you did. But no, it was a good life. I mean, it was, well, as they say, a hard life, maybe, but I didn't mind it. I enjoyed it.
Well, it was a little slower pace than it is now.
Oh, it was much different. Much different. Yeah. Oh, yes, we had a lot of... Oh, you come out and you'd have to go to Rumford and you go there, visiting around. And always the first Saturday night you was out, you always had to go to Potato Hole to dance. those were some of the things that went on.
Catch up on all the news.
Oh, yes.
Well, Allan, we've enjoyed this very much this morning.
Well,
and
I've enjoyed doing it.
Thank you very much.
Well, I think you're very welcome.
I think we've got a great interview.
Well, I hope so.
Thank you.